Okay, so good afternoon and welcome. Hope the sound and the slides are coming through well. My name is Dieter van Uitvank, and it's my pleasure today to be the host from Claire and Eric of this linked open data Claire and Cafe. And we have today quite a nice agenda, I think, with a good diversity of topics. But to get started, let me first say some words of thanks to the organizers, to Fahad, Penny, and Marco for co-organizing this virtual cafe session. And as I said, I'm Dieter van Uitvank, I'm the technical director, and I'm your host from the site of Claren. This event is being recorded for further dissemination purposes. Please be aware of that. If you don't want to be recorded, please make sure you keep your microphone and your camera muted. If you have any questions or comments, you can use the chat box of Zoom, and we will then pick up on those questions. Good. First, a quick introduction to what Claren is. Obviously, this is a bit of information you can also find on our website, but we thought that as kind of a short context sketch for this session today, might be good to quickly summarize what Claren is about. Well, it stands for the Common Language Resources and Technology Infrastructure. It's a distributed research infrastructure, which has the S3 ERIC status since 2012. Next year will be our anniversary year, 10th anniversary. And since 2016, Claren has been recognized as a landmark by S3. Now, what is it actually doing as a research infrastructure? Claren is providing easy and sustainable access for scholars in the humanities and the social sciences and beyond to both digital language data and advanced tools. Language data is a very broad category. It covers all kind of modalities, written, spoken, video, multimodal, whatever you have. Claren also tries to provide easy access to advanced tools to discover the language data sets or to explore them, exploit, annotate, analyze, combining them, wherever these tools and language data sets are located. So we're a distributed infrastructure, and the nice thing is that you can combine data from there with tools from another location, for instance. Obviously, this is something where the linked data theme also comes in. Wherever needed, we try to provide this through a single sign-on environment, so that if you need to log in somewhere, that you can use your own institutional credentials, your username and your password from your own university to access resources that are remotely available if they're not openly available by default. Claren is serving as an ecosystem for knowledge sharing also. I mean, it also relates to today's theme. We're trying to exchange a lot of information and know-how on all kinds of relevant topics. And Claren is also an integral part of the European Open Science Cloud. There's a whole story behind this, but I suggest you take a look at claren.eu/eosc. There you will find more details of how we are powering the eosc. So how does Claren look today organizationally? As said, we're a distributed infrastructure, which consists out of centers. At the moment, we have 68 centers. Most of them are situated in Europe, but we also have some centers in the US at Carnegie Mellon University. In South Africa, we also have a full consortium over there. If you want to have a full overview of all the members and the consortia, please go to our website. There you can click through and find more information about your local Claren consortium. Good. Some quick words on our technical infrastructure set. We're distributed, so Claren is actively harvesting metadata from our technical centers, is then making those metadata sets searchable through a catalog that we called Virtual Language Observatory. And then in the next step, when you found relevant resources for your specific purpose, research purpose, you can then use all kinds of tools that are, for instance, being connected through the language resource switchboard, which allows you to make that kind of connection between the data on the one hand and the tools that are around on the other hand. There's a lot to be said there. You can find some links here, at the bottom of the page. So clarin.eu/fair about how this all ensures that we have findability, accessibility, interoperability, and reusability in focus. You can have a look at the Virtual Language Observatory or the switchboard and just play a bit around there. I think it says more than a more theoretical introduction. So please take a look at those websites. Some final words on our knowledge infrastructure. As you can find on our website, we're doing a lot of efforts also trying to make sure that Clarin is more than just the technology, but it is also about making sure that we actively spread and cross-connect the know-how that is available in our centers. For that purpose, we have our so-called knowledge centers, but there's also other means that we have. So this, together with our Daria colleagues, we're hosting maintaining the Digital Humanities Course registry. We have video platforms such as video lectures where you can take a look at recordings, for instance, from earlier annual conferences or specific workshops. We have mobility grants in case you want to invite an expert to come to your center to look into a specific topic. There's funding for user involvement events. We have a program for setting up a trainer network. There's a lot of activities in this training scene as well. And same goes for the training suite that is mentioned here. And we have workshops like the one today, actually. Good, something more on how Clarin relates to linked open data and by extension, linguistic linked open data. I think summary of this slide would be so far that most efforts that have been made are bottom up. Actually, I think a majority of the things within the Clarin infrastructure, the initiative lies a lot with the individual centers, the know-how, the expertise that is around there. And so we've seen popping up at all kind of occasions, some interesting uses of linguistic linked open data. And I've just named a few here. I'm sure I've forgotten tons of examples, but this is just to give a bit of an idea of the variety that there is. And if you have additional examples that I've forgotten here, please feel free to mention them in the chat or later on in the discussions. I don't claim in any way that this is an exhaustive list. But just to go through a few examples, for instance, some of the repositories of the centers, the Arche one, for instance, from Vienna, is making use of linked open data for the data and the metadata storage and connectivity. We've had some papers at previous annual conferences, like for instance, the colleagues from Leipzig who have been using linked data techniques for creating lexical resources for languages of South Africa. There's some links in the slides that will be distributed to the abstracts and also a video recording of this presentation. There's our colleagues from ILC who will also be here today and will present later on, who've done some posters on using enriching digital classics through linked open data. Our Dutch colleagues from the Claria Consortium have been doing a lot in terms of metadata extraction and connectivity to the linked data scene with the SIMD2 RDF project. There's software stacks being developed in ClariaNL like Timbuktu and the Anansi instantiation, which is actually the Claria linked open data gateway for ClariNL. There's been a whole workshop series in Claria on the topic. And finally, but definitely not the last point, is the Talk of Europe, where earlier on there's been a lot of effort going in the project actually to make a linked open data set based on the debates of the European Parliament, and trying to extract all kind of relevant example cases out of that to demonstrate the value and the potential for exploitation of linked data sets based on this. There's definitely a lot more to be told, and that's where I'm glad that we can continue to the actual content of the cafe.